The affirmative.
There you go.
Now, in a context where corporations have successfully pushed for things like unlimited funding in Congress, where they fund both parties in the American Congress to adhere to their interests, in a context where they're flooding think tanks like the RAND Corporation, like the Club for Growth, to flood the airwaves to influence society to their interests, in a context where corporations have made themselves explicit opponents of environmental and banking regulation throughout the United States and throughout the First World, the key question in this debate is it wise to allow these entities with very clearly outlined interests to influence the sphere of academic, not research as a whole, but academic research? That is the key question in today's debate.
Yeah.
I'm going to look at two issues in this debate. First, the necessity of corporate funding, and secondly, the effects of corporate funding on research and whether that will be detrimental. First and foremost, the issue of necessity. And the key crux of logic coming from that side of the house is that we need this funding to push the boundaries of human knowledge, and by the way, corporations have rights. On the first level, we agree, and this is the smallest point, corporations do have rights, but the rights are awarded to them insofar as they facilitate human rights, like the right to commerce. When it does not, we limit their rights through things like labor standards and environmental standards, which are, by the way, things that corporations are trying to undermine right now. But secondly, we are not restricting their rights entirely at all. They still have the right to employ their own scientists. The very company they talk about, like Pfizer, like Monsanto, spend millions of dollars every year on their own scientists in their own corporations anyway, and they fulfill the interest of market-based research very, very well. The question they have to answer, and they fail to answer, is why exactly are this not enough to fulfill corporate interest in corporate research, and why exactly do they need to incur into the territory of economic research? And that's my next point of rebuttal. The nature of academic research is characterized by Imran that they've never, ever engaged with, because the paradigm of academic research has never been solely about usefulness to society or the profit incentive. It is to push the boundaries of academic knowledge, even though they may violate transient political trends or transient economic trends, for instance. That's why you have things like security of tenure, to ensure that things that may not necessarily be popular, they may not be opposed, but that can still advance the field of human knowledge, that evolution in the time of Charles Darwin can potentially still have a place. And this is very important because things like theorems and equations take decades upon decades to do it. That's how it's different from economic and corporate research, ladies and gentlemen. The question they have to answer is why these two particular interests should be mixed. Later on, I'll show you how their policy will undermine this crucial space for academic research. The last point they say is the idea of ideological biases if alternatives are allowed in. On the first level, there is a concession that one particular ideological bias within the field of research is bad, and as long as we show you later on that corporations have a disproportionate effect in terms of ideological bias, we already win this debate. Secondly, they say that governments will dominate. On the first level, we never say that governments will be the sole provider of money for this particular research. That is just disingenuous. Imran has already said things like rich individuals, the universities themselves, even local groups like NACP will also fund research, and they will still number in the millions and millions of dollars. It may not be the $300 billion that Goldman Sachs have, but research can still be done, ladies and gentlemen. And the question that they have to answer is why would these people not walk away once corporations start to fund them? Why would these people who may have private interest in advancing private knowledge that may not be linked to corporations, what say will these individuals have anymore once corporations are able to dominate the discourse? And even if government has overweighting, and why within government, once one represents the majority, and whilst we think they should not dominate, they should still have a say as well. Corporations, on the other hand, are different, like I said just now. Lastly, they say we don't like political corporations. That is very weird, because we have to characterize, and they've never disagreed, the point that corporations are eminently political. They're always involved in the political process, always trying to influence Congress, always trying to influence the president. So how exactly is their political influence necessarily worse off? They've never once engaged with that. So we have never shown that there's a fundamental necessity to have corporations with all their largesse and the nature of their interests necessarily influencing academic research. So let's look at the second issue, the effects of their policy on academic research. A few points here. The first thing they said, Ellie said, was that this will diminish risk-taking. That doesn't make sense. Profit-motivated corporations are the ones who are most likely to disincentivize risk-taking because they are based on results, ladies and gentlemen. If you want things like academic theorems, for instance, equations to come, you need decades upon decades of trial and error for that to happen. Corporations, on the other hand, want results, and the chances of them pulling the plug on a particular research that may not produce results in 2 or 3 years is immense. That is when you disincentivize risk-taking, not under our particular paradigm, where private researchers may be more indulgent in terms of trial and error. The The second thing they say is that there's a greater visibility, there are checks and balances, they will never ever lie. Two responses to this. We think firstly, in terms of things like think tanks, the RAND Corporation, generally, and Iman has already said this, people don't know which corporations are funding which particular thing. Then the Joe voters were influenced by corporations flooding the areas through things like the RAND Corporation, like the platform for health, like Fox News, ladies and gentlemen, don't generally see whether or not Amway or Goldman Sachs is funding them or not. So we cannot allow them this particular sheen of respectability. If they're fighting for corporate interest, they must be seen to be fighting for corporate interest. It must be part they never dealt with. But secondly, I say this time and time again, this nuanced our case, they don't have to lie. All they have to do is to de-emphasize certain research, fund one particular research more, to crowd out other research that may be against their interests, like for instance, research combating the rise of fossil fuels or things like that. They say we are blocking truth from coming out. We bring you a radical proposition that there's no such thing as an objective truth. Only aspects of the truth that can be emphasized and de-emphasized, and within corporations will emphasize that aspect of the truth that is beneficial to them. And that is incredibly harmful. This brings me on then to the last point and most important point. Our corporations, do corporations work against social interests? And they say they could not. On the first level, they've never contested without context. Intrinsic to corporations are certain interests that are antithetical to social interests. Firstly, ladies and gentlemen, because they work on the basis of quarterly reviews and quarterly profits, that is why if there's a new technology, the new alternative fuel that could potentially lower people's reliance on oil, for instance, and that hurts a quarterly profit, which is incredibly short-term, then chances are they might discontinue that, they might not fund that. Secondly, we say they often oppose non-market-based solutions, like open-source research into drugs, for instance, that Imran talks about. They may not be all there is, but it's an invaluable path that should continue to be researched. In all this context, we think they crawl out certain aspects of the discourse, certain aspects of knowledge that should still be dead. But secondly, even if they do not work against social interests per se, I think both sides agree that they work towards self-aggrandizement. That is always the purpose of corporation. This is where the most important part of our case comes in. When you compare the $800 billion or so that Goldman Sachs has to fund research against everyone else who could potentially fund them, who have competing priorities, who do not have money for millions upon millions of taxpayers to influence research, we think their influence will be disproportionately large. And even if they say that these individuals have some socially beneficial outcomes, we think these outcomes will come at the expense of crowding out other equally important fields of research. This is especially important since their interests can already be advanced through corporate funding, through corporate scientists, ladies and gentlemen, who do not necessarily work in academia. Under these circumstances, we think democracy is predicated on everyone having some say and no one being overly crowded out. And we think they create this crowding out effect that is incredibly, incredibly detrimental. Lastly, even if their influence isn't malignant, this is what Emma told you, the perception of malignant interests will still be there, ladies and gentlemen. What are the chances of people, other people, willing to fund them, willing to trust academic research if they know the taint of BP with its oil spill mess is behind that particular research? We think that's very bad, and they'll also discredit academic research, and we also do not want that. Ladies and gentlemen, as someone who's hoping to drop out a very stressful law career for a career in academia, I don't want corporations influencing my research. I want research to be free, I want speech to be free, and that is why I am proud to propose.